I got a phone call to get out the building. Come back to this. The whole place is in shambles.
This to the church.
There's some sick people out there that need prayer. Everything that we built, the lives that we changed, now our temple is just rubble. That's what are we gonna do?
We'll rebuild. That's what we will do. We will rebuild. This is the kind of church. Deacon, we are the church, and we will rebuild. Ain't nobody gonna stop us. They won't stop us. This won't stop us.
Between me and the other world, there is ever an unasked question. Unasked by some through feelings of delicacy, by others through the difficulty of rightly framing it. All, nevertheless, flutter round it. They approach me in a half-hesitant sort of way, eye me curiously or compassionately, and then, instead of saying directly, "How does it feel to be a problem?"
How does it feel to be a problem? How does it feel to be the least of these beneath all of the begotten? To be downtrodden, to feel you are forgotten, to live within the margins, a life filled with hardships, a path watered with the sobbing of the brokenhearted, to walk a path that is cobbled with losses, to walk the stony road that your ancestors trod. How does it feel to be a problem when you feel this way often? The U.S. launches experiment in democracy and pawned us off as its most virulent property. It's original text denied its seminal bequest to the sons of Ham, Cush, Nubia, Egypt. But I suppose that is how experiments go. The problem with them though is someone must be the control. Someone must be the tape by which other men measure their souls. When you look at the probe, you'll see the souls of black folk.
You have seen our children dying. You have heard their mothers crying. Lord, have mercy on the souls of black folk. You have seen our spirits striving. You have heard our fathers sighing. Lord, whatever will be come of our souls.
How does it feel to be a problem? I answer seldom a word. There's sufficient rancor there to observe. 250 years of slavery, 90 of Jim Crow. Separate but equal, it will sear men's souls. So when they lifted their voices, you could hear their moans. 10 generations born under the rattle of chains, who had nothing more than the refrain of their claim. This is the battle of those living in the shadow of chattel, who feel like the depths of their hopes are shallow, who have seen pastoral scenes morph to scaffolds, from redwood forest to New York's Big Apple. And you don't believe that we're heavy laden by Satan, when the state has treated us like apes whose fur has been shaven. We behave in ways that holds that in high regard. It's like folly has overtaken that mind of ours, and that folly has done all type of harm.
You have seen our children dying. You have heard the mothers crying. Lord, have mercy on the souls of black folk. You have seen our spirits striving. You have heard our fathers sighing. Lord, whatever will be come of our souls.
It would seem the task is arduous, but if there is no struggle, there is no progress. We have to fight to see these things the way that our God does. But now we see through a glass darkly. The flask we grasp blurs the view of our feet. Yes, we see partly, but we see hardly. We don't see the path that we are embarking. But if we are to rise up above the color line and above it rise, there must come a time to see the truth as self-evident, and otherwise live the true meaning of our creed and let the struggle die. Maybe we can let the struggle die. One day we can let the struggle die.